we're actually so fortunate in Victoria here that living kind of in the, basically the hotbed of astronomy in Canada. And as a society, we have this incredibly rich pool of astronomers and students and even a lot of our own members to call on to speak at these monthly meetings and to speak at some of our outreach events. And tonight we're incredibly fortunate to have a visitor from the University of Hong Kong speak to us tonight. Professor Sun Kwok's research areas are astrochemistry and stellar evolution. He is director of the Laboratory for Space Research at the University of Hong Kong in Hong Kong, China. His recent research has been on the topic of synthesis of complex organic compounds in the late stages of stellar evolution. He is the author of many books, including The Origin of and Evolution of Planetary Nebulae, Cosmic Butterflies, Physics and Chemistry of the Interstellar Medium, Organic Matter in the Universe, and of course tonight's topic, Stardust, the Cosmic Seeds of Life. He's been a guest observer on many space missions, including the Hubble Telescope and the Infrared Space Observatory. He currently serves as president of the International Astronomical Union's Commission on Astrobiology. Previously, he has served as the president of the IAU's Commission on Interstellar Matter and chairman of the IAU's Planetary Nebulae Working Group. So please give a warm RESC welcome to Professor Sun.
Can you hear me okay without a microphone?
It's all right. Always enjoy the visit. Now, I'm going to talk about the origin of life, which is a big topic. If I were to talk about this 30-some years ago, I may be mostly talking about speculation. But really, a lot has happened in the last 20, 30 years. And the Astronomical Union, as we learned that has been organizing meetings on astrobiology. It has been going on every 3 years for a number of years. This time was in Japan.
Yes.
And although this astrobiology meeting has been going on for 20-some years, last time in Japan we had 400 people coming all over the world. The next year you'll be in Chile. And we are really seeing a new field of astronomy, which is getting extremely active. And I want to give a little bit of background and about some of the old ideas which have been around for a long time, for of course thousands of years. A lot of our human society, some society, thought that life came as a result of some supernatural intervention, and recently there may be some variation of this theme, saying that maybe there are some even more advanced extraterrestrial civilization. They came to us, they found something, and that got life started on Earth. Now, a very popular idea for a long time also is the idea of panspermia, and the idea is that we have Earth, have life because they have been life somewhere else. And they were brought here by either accident or by transport. And but of course, this doesn't solve the problem of the origin of life because it has to start somewhere else. And it just delayed the problem to somewhere else. Now, also for a few hundred years, it has been popular, the idea of spontaneous creation. That means that life could have coming from the non-living, and there seem to be some superficial examples that in our everyday experience that we think that this could be happening. For example, that from decaying meat, we can see worms coming out, and that seems to be an example of life coming out from non-living, but actually this turned out not to be the case, as it was demonstrated that if you are careful and not allow any contamination from the air, for example, that this will never happen. So as of now, today, we think we come to the conclusion that now life can only come from life, and that you cannot have a situation that you can create life out of the laboratory, for example. Now, what are the constituents of life? Now, with the development of chemistry, in particular biochemistry, then we now learn that our body, which are made up of cells and so on, they're all being put together by various different kinds of molecules, and all these molecules have functions, and the general term for that is organic molecules. Now, so as late as a couple hundred years ago, it was still commonly believed that maybe something separates the living from the non-living, and that is something is called vitality. So if you, all the organic molecules that are in our bodies, in the bodies of trees or animals, they have something different. So just like in the past, we used to believe that what separates animals from humans is that we have souls, animals don't. But this also became a little shaky because in the 19th century it became possible in the laboratory to artificially synthesize the different kinds of organic molecules. And this gradually led to the giving up the concept of vitality. We think that if organic molecules that are taken from biological organisms can be reproduced or created from the laboratory, then maybe there's nothing really special about organic molecules. So the development of chemistry led us to now to believe that organic matter, which is just a component of biological mechanisms, organisms, can come from the non-living. Now, however, things are very different in the past. Now, we now learn, since we used to think that the Earth was a few thousand years old, then maybe millions of years old, tens of millions of years old. About less than 100 years ago, we learned that the Earth is actually billions of years old. Now, things were very different then. Although now we don't believe that life can come up from the non-living, that may not have been true in the past. So there was a hypothesis that in the distant past, at the beginning of the creation of the Earth, then by synthesizing with simple ingredients, so long they have a suitable environment, then they can be put together and where life could emerge. So what was needed may be some environment that is conducive to this kind of things happening, or some kind of energy input into the system. So the pioneers of this kind of thinking was basically in the early part of the 20th century, partly as a result of the development of chemistry and biochemistry. So that the hypothesis is that life could be solely the result of physics and chemistry, and we could start with the simplest ingredients, and then we can gradually build up from simple to more complex, and then to a living organism. Now, the many people would say that the turning point for this idea is the Urey experiment in 1953, where in the University of Chicago, in a simple laboratory, they put in some simple molecules that at that time thought to be common in the early environment of the Earth, namely water, hydrogen, methane, ammonia, and you inject some energy, in this case electrical energy, and just let it sit, and remarkably, within a few days, we can see at the bottom of the flask that there are all kinds of complex organic molecules, including proteins, carbohydrates, lipids, and so on. So that got people extremely excited. So that seemed to be an indication that by a suitable environment and input of energy, and you have some starting with very simple ingredients, then you can have complex organic molecules just happening on their own. Now, this idea has been extremely popular, I would say, to now. What I'm going to talk about today is to present you another possibility. So, I'm going to try to present some evidence that the Earth, if life indeed came from all these simple ingredients, maybe we had a head start in doing so, because now we are finding that very complex organic compounds can be made by stars, and they very likely have been delivered to the surface of the Earth. Now, there are several aspects of this this idea, and one aspect is delivery. Now, as all of you know, that the moon is full of craters, and in the past, the common ideas, maybe up to even the early part of the 20th century, was that these craters are volcanic in origin. So you have this shape of craters, and they represent volcanoes, which we do have a lot on the surface of the Earth. And that's why they have all these surface features on the moon. But now we think differently, that these are all impact craters. Now, I mean, of course, the most famous example is the crater in Arizona, and it has been a very controversial subject, because Gilbert, which used to be the most famous geologist in the United States, and he believed that this crater in Arizona is a volcanic in origin, and they only later in the 20th century that people began to suspect that through, for example, experiments in the laboratory, that this could be the end result of external bombardment. So Bowen, for example, he did work in the Second World War on explosions, and he did experiments on putting on impacts and trying to see the result of the shapes and the marks left by the impacts, and came to the conclusion that the lunar craters are really impact craters. So now we know that by extrapolation, that you, in order to create a crater of certain size, you need an impact object of a certain size. And now these craters are really not only in the moon, but actually all over the solar system. So we have craters on Mars, which is Mercury, for example, have able to take images and say that we learn that there are also impact craters on the on Mercury. And now the Earth, being a larger body, actually should have had much more impact in the past than a smaller body like the moon. But it's not easy to find them, because there have been a lot of geological activities on the Earth over the last several billion years. And although there have been a large number of impact craters, a number of them that are actually visible today are much fewer. So this is a recent discovery. There's a crater in China, and you can see that shape of topography can be explained quite well with the result of impact. Now, what we have learned is that Earth is not a closed system. So we have been subject to huge amount of impact in the past, in particular in the first 700 million years of the Earth's history. And these bombardments still continue today, but they are continuing at a much lower rate. Yeah, of course, there are other kind of evidence. You're all familiar with the theory of the origin of the moon. Moon is believed to be the result of a Mars-sized object hitting the Earth and lifting the outer part of the Earth to condense and become the moon that we have today. And there are also a large group of scientists believe that the reason that we have oceans for a large amount of water on Earth is because they were brought in by comets. Now, so that's the aspect of delivery. Now, we on Earth, we have a lot of organic matter. Now, this organic matter, let me go back a little bit. So they are all powerful in origin, but not so much in terms of in the form of trees or animals and so on. Now, the largest body of organics on Earth actually is in the form of kerogen, which is some sedimentary, you find in sedimentary rocks, they are made of, it's just like petroleum and coal, they were left over from living organisms a long time ago. But as far as we know, all the organics that we have on Earth can be traced back to a living matter. Now, what we're trying to talk about today is the possibility that actually complex organics are not necessarily all have to be of biological origin. Now, some of the things, the basics we all know quite well, that our bodies are made up of chemical elements, and we need certain elements in order to function. We need calcium, iodine, and iron, and zinc, and manganese. And all these elements, as it was discovered in the 1950s, are making stars through nuclear reactions. And we have 85 natural elements, and other than hydrogen and helium, all the other elements were making stars, particularly in old stars. So every part of our body, if you break them down into the little entities of atoms, then you can say that it's a star in connection, because all the heavy elements came from a star at one time. So, the sun is only making helium, but when it's getting older, then it can become, you can make other heavy elements. First one we make is carbon, and then later the heavy elements, which are made by the process of neutron capture, later decay, and so on. These things are happening over a very short period of time, it just right at the end of a star's life. So we do know that there are some elementary process going on in terms of element synthesis, and they bring us the elements of heavy and hydrogen here. So we all know also that the sun become a red giant, and one time you go past the orbit of Mercury, Venus, and even to the surface of the Earth, sun will become thousands of times brighter than he is now. And interesting thing is that it was found in the last maybe 100 million years or so of this red giant stage that the sun will develop a stellar wind, which is about a billion times stronger than he is now. Now, through the techniques of microwave and infrared astronomy, we know that this is a common path that will be passed through by 95% of all the stars as they and the environment of the old stars in these stellar winds, which we know quite well. And over 70 some molecules are seen in this ejector of old stars. And they have organics and rings and records and stuff. So they, another interesting thing is that if you see a molecule, say in the set of carbon, you don't know how long it has been around. But whereas in the star, we do that, because these elements are moving. So if you see a molecule, then we know that they have to be generated within that state of wind. We know that wind is moving, therefore, for example, they can not be more than, say, 10,000 years old. So we have a situation that we have a site of molecular synthesis. We look at these surroundings of the old stars, and we can tell all these things were freshly made, and they have not been around for many years or 10 million years. They were made just thousands of years ago. Now, another aspect is solar state particles. Now, astronomers have been aware that there are solar state particles in the Milky Way galaxy, for example, because they could see that there are certain parts, for example, like the Milky Way, that there are certain black spots. That's because solid particles are there blocking away the light from the stars in the background. Now, but direct observations of solid particles is another matter. Now, because these solid particles, when they radiate in the infrared, and we did not have infrared detecting technology until the late 1960s. So, it was first detected by astronomers at night in 1969 using an infrared detector and telescope they developed at the University of Minnesota. And when they did that, no one believed them. Because they see a lot of this infrared light coming from very old stars. And astronomers all know that the coolest star is 3,000 degrees. And 3,000 degrees, object would radiate at a wavelength of 1 micron, whereas Wolf and I detect the things that are coming out at 10 micron, meaning that they are at a temperature of 300 degrees. And so this is contrary to expectation, and certainly there is no reason to believe these things are coming from stars. So what they were able to conclude is that those are not stellar radiation. They are coming from solid state particles that are being created and ejected from these old stars. So now these solid state particles, they also have signatures, and one can, for example, compare with what we can measure in the laboratory, and the first example they identified is due to amorphous silicates, which is like common sand. So now the first infrared telescope was the Infrared Space Observatory, which was launched in the 1980s. Now the good thing about a satellite is that it can get out of our Earth atmosphere. And our Earth atmosphere is a big nuisance because it blocks away most of the infrared light. So although there are so-called some windows that we can use from a telescope on Earth, but to have a clear sky, so to speak, that we have to the telescope in space. And you can see that a survey of the galaxy turned out that these kind of features, which are due to silicates, are very common. So almost every old star that you see in a certain age group, that means right at the end, they are making solid state silicate particles. Now, how do they form? Theoretically, it's impossible because we know that if you heat something up, that things will melt. You put a certain piece of metal or some sand that you put it at high temperature, they will vaporize. And stars are relatively hot. You have say a 3,000 degree star, which is about the coolest that we have, and then the condensation temperature of these dust particles is only about 1,000 degrees. Now, however, there is no doubt that these things are happening because we do see that in this stellar ejector, in this stellar wind, that dust particles are being formed. Now, actually, now we have even better examples. For example, in a nova, we can follow the outburst of a nova, and after a couple of months, over a period of 3 days, we form these cicadas. So nature is much more smarter than us. So although theoretically we understand how they can be done, but observationally there's no doubt that nature is able to make solid state particles under extremely low density environment. I keep saying that these environments are much more than the best vacuum that we can create in the laboratory. And yet they can somehow be able to bring in thousands of atoms together and make it into a solid state particle. So the second infrared satellite was the infrared space observatory, which is European satellite. And then this satellite being more sensitive, they would detect all kinds of minerals. So just going through quickly, there are a lot of things that will be, for example, ruby or sapphire, which are basically just chemicals or minerals that they have all been detected in old stars. So we say that we are now in the era of stellar meteorology, because there are minerals that have been made in stars that we can try to study. Now, some of you already know that I work on planetary nebulae, and these are the last stage of stellar evolution that the death of a sun-like star. So in the last maybe 30,000 years or so after the red giant stage that we were talking about earlier, that the sun, for example, most likely, or at least stars that are slightly heavier than the sun, will become a planetary nebula. Velocity, which is much larger than our solar system, and is very interesting to look at. I'm sure all of you have seen them in a telescope because they are colorful, and they're colorful because they radiated strongly in various atomic lines. Now, so what was not expected was that when infrared observations began, well, I mentioned that they first began on the Earth-based observatory and also later on satellites, but in the 1970s they could be done, for example, in high-flying aircraft. So this is the Carr-Webmaster Observatory. A number of my fellow students from both the University of Missouri and the University of California, San Diego, they flew on the Airborne Observatory and use the infrared detectors to try to look at some planetary nebulae, and to the big surprise, they see something that no one had ever seen before. There's a series of features which are extremely bright in the starting from about 3 micron all the way to about 12 micron, and these features are so strong, and yet when they look into atomic catalogs, they cannot find any corresponding features coming out from atoms. And so this is the NGC 727, which is a young planetary nebula. There's the spectrum, which is a better one taken later by the ISO satellite. But you can see that there are features. Some of them are, the narrow ones are atomic ones, and those are well known. But there are some broader ones at 3.3, 6.2, 7.7, 8.6, 0.3 microns. Those are broader features that no one has seen before, and therefore they're called unidentified infrared features. Now, it was recognized actually quite early that almost right after discovery, in two papers published in Nature, they identified the 3.3 micron features due to the stretching of hydrogen moving away from carbon in so-called aromatic compounds. That aromatic compounds are ring-like molecules. So these things are basic ingredients in many organic molecules, but no one paid any attention to those papers, because
because for astronomer thing, it's impossible to have organic species in space. And now, about 10 years later, more and more observations found that many planetary nebulae have these kind of features. And since planetary nebulae are very short-lived phenomena, because they are expanding, it will disperse within the stellar medium in a matter of a couple of tens of thousands of years. So they have to be made right there by the stars. And actually, the identification is not difficult by in hindsight, because all in the 1960s, the chemists in the lab have been using techniques of infrared spectroscopy to look at all kinds of organic compounds. And you look at a handbook of chemistry, you can identify all these features. So some of them are due to stretching bows, and some of them are due to bending bows. So we call in-plane bending along the plane of the molecule, and some of them are bending, bending out of the plane of the molecule. And so some of the strongest features are well known to be associated with aromatic compounds. Now the thing is that since planetary nebulae are only a couple of tens of thousands of years old, when did these things first synthesized? Now, we also know that tens of thousands of red giant stars have been looked at. They have been found to have minerals, but none of them have this kind of organic features. And so there is a big mystery on how come there is sudden change between the red giant stage and the planetary nebula stage. And to me, it seems that the only way we can find out is to look at the evolutionary stage in between. Now that, in the early 1990s, none of them were known. And oh, this is another story, but we have to try to first find those objects and those things are called protoplanetary nebulae. And over the number of years working with Bruce Redneck, and we have discovered over 30 of these protoplanetary nebulae. Now, just to give an example, now planetary nebulae are very bright because they have atomic lines. But these things are not bright because they are the atomic lines are not yet atomic lines are due to polarization. The atoms may become ions, and if the stars are not yet hot enough, they won't have this kind of atomic lines. So these protoplanetary nebulae, the light that you are seeing, for example, in this Hubble Space Telescope region, they are all refracted by stardust. So these are some examples of the objects that we discovered, and in particular like the name that we give to the silkworm nebula, because it gives a very good connotation that a butterfly is coming out from the cocoon. Now, after we find these objects, we take some spectroscopy. And there are, for example, the feature that had been known before, the 3.3 micron feature, due to thick stretch of aromatic compounds, and then we also see another feature at 3.4 micron. And those were not known previously, and it turns out these features, that the weaker ones, are due to aliphatic compounds. Now, aliphatic compounds are unlike the aromatics, they are not, the aromatics are ring-like, the aliphatics are the chain-like. They are things that, for example, make up carbon and hydrogen. In addition, to ring-like aromatic compounds, they're also chain-like aliphatic compounds. Now the question is, what is the chemical structure of these things? Now it's one thing to say, oh, I have seen some signatures of the stretching and bending of the groups, chemical groups, but it's another thing to say that, well, what is the overall chemical structure? Now, it's a very complicated story, but for example, in France, which is a country which we're keen about, which used to be
co-producer producer that we take a look at the infraspectra of coal. And that related is a kerogen, which is a precursor of coal, which is a tar-like organic substance, which are very commonly found on the surface of the earth in sedimentary rocks. Actually, most of the, by far, most of the organic compounds on earth are in the form of a kerogen, and they are insoluble because they are very complex, and they are irregular, and they are quite different from the simple molecules that we are accustomed to talking about, for example, in chemistry textbooks. Now, this gives you an idea how complex it is. The dark areas are the bromelic rings, and the light lines are the fatty chains. These are randomly distributed aromatic rings, which are being connected by aliphatic chains through a variety of lengths and angles and so on. So if I can't present all evidence here, but the thing that we are, the astronomical spectrum that we are seeing actually are the most resemble the infrared signatures of these kerogens. So now, how about in our solar system? And we are talking about now, we know that there are organics being made by stars. How about in the solar system? Now, in the solar system, we do know there are lots of rocks, there are lots of minerals, and we know that for some time. Asteroids, which is a piece of rock, we have interplanetary dust, which is smaller, sand-like, smaller than sand. They are present all over the solar system. I mean, even the Earth that we are standing on can be talked about as just a big piece of rock. And we do have things that fall on Earth, the remnants of asteroids. They fall on Earth, they left on the surface of Earth in the form of meteorites. And it's also very interesting that because of going back as far as Aristotle, that thought that while the heavens are pure and unchangeable, where things on earth are dirty and always changeable, and therefore for a long time people first thought that comets were an atmospheric phenomenon, and definitely any stone that fell that we can pick up just originally from the earth itself. So it was not until the 19th century that we realized that when we look at a piece of meteorites, these are actually extraterrestrial. So, well, this is a great thing because we can, for a change, hold in our hands a piece of matter which is coming from space. And the good thing is that now we can put them in a laboratory, we can subject them to all kinds of chemical and physical analysis, we can take pictures, we can take spectra. So we can learn a lot about rocks in space through the study of meteorites. Now, one of the things that surprised everyone is the discovery of organics. So two professors in New York, they first presented a paper in 1961 about discovering of organics in meteorites. Again, no one believed them because the belief at that time was that natural organics could only come from the earth. Now, nowadays, because we have all kinds of laboratory equipment, we can analyze the pieces of meteorites either by, if it's drastic, we can burn them, we can cook them. If you don't want to change the material itself, you can take spectra in the X-ray, in the infrared, all kinds of ways we can look at them. And now, we have learned that in the so-called soluble component of meteorites, these are carbon-rich meteorites, every kind of biological-related organic molecules have been identified. Okay. So any organic molecule that we have known in the chemistry laboratory have been found in meteorites. Now, people say, well, how do you know it's not due to contamination? Because instead of the 20 amino acids that are in our body, over 100 different kinds of amino acids have been found in vitro. So these cannot be due to contamination. And there are isotopic relations. The solar system have certain degree, certain signatures of ratios of isotopes. They can show that they are more, they are not coming from the solar system. And even nuclear bases, the bases that make up DNA and RNA, we have only 5 nuclear bases, but yet in vitro there are many more. So again, this cannot be due to result of contamination. So what we know is that nature can make all kinds of very complex, biologically relevant compounds without involving life. Now, more interestingly, 70% of the organics in meteorites are so-called insoluble. So they cannot be dissolved. The reason they cannot be dissolved is the chemical structure are too complex. So they, nevertheless, they can be studied, and one can determine, for example, what's the ratio of the makeup of atoms. You know that they are not primary due to have carbons in them, there are some hydrogen, there are oxygen, sulfur, nitrogen, and so on. And you can also, through either X-ray or infrared spectroscopic techniques, identify the structure. So they found to have islands of aromatic rings and also extensive network of aliphatic chains. So these things are the products of abiotic chemistry. They are not like kerogen or coal or petroleum. They are not breakdown products of life. They are things that are made up from, we don't know how, from the smallest component up without involving life. Comets. Now we can find comets. We have missions that can fly through a comet. We can even collect materials from a comet. And just a few days ago, something you followed the news, you heard about news from the Rosetta mission, that they have collected tens of thousands of solid state particles from the comet, and those are being analyzed, and they found to have large macromolecular compound, which is similar to the insoluble organic matter. In the stardust particles. So these are very small particles, size microns or less, and they can be collected in a number of ways. You can send a high-flying aircraft to the upper atmosphere and collect them, or they also fall on the ground. They fall on the ground at a rate of about 30,000 tons per year. And in Antarctica, because it's all covered by ice, they're very easily identified, they won't be mixed up with the mud and rock and trees and grass on the other parts of the earth. And these things can be analyzed, and you can analyze and you can see they have these kind of infrastructures which are similar to what we see in the planetary nebula and protoplanetary nebula. Now, Titan. Now, we also know that the Cassini went to Titan, and they set a hook down to the surface, and in the process they have analyzed the sample both in the atmosphere and also on the surface, which had sand dunes and lakes and so on, and there's a huge amount of organics on the surface of Titan. The estimate is that the amount of organics, the lakes and the sand dunes, are more than the total gas and oil reserves that we have. So, obviously, this has nothing to do with life. So, our solar system are quite capable of making all kinds of complex organics similar to kerogen that we have on Earth. I'm just raising this question. Of course, we have any answer for that. At least we don't have any evidence present time that the my body of that hydrocarbons on Earth, but you keep seeing all the hydrocarbons that we have are the decay product of life. So now, because there are all kinds of organic compounds, both simple and complex, in meteorites and in the planetary dust particles and on comets and surface of planetary satellites, they are all the basic ingredients for life are already there. And they are made all abiological. They are built up from scratch and been somehow made with the kind of complexity that we have seen today. Now, this is quite different from, say, 40, 50 years ago, where the consensus at that time, at the beginning of the solar nebula, when it was formed, it was so hostile that any pre-existing material, either molecules or solid, would totally be destroyed. So everything we see in the solar system will make it fresh. Now, we are not so sure this is true anymore, because the comets, for example, they are very old objects. And some of these carbonaceous chondrites that we see in meteorites, they represent the oldest part of the solar system. So these things, these organics, were already there at the beginning of the solar system. And also that, as we mentioned earlier, that in the first several hundred million years of the Earth's history, we were subject to a huge amount of bombardment, and these bombardments are due to asteroids, for example, remnants of asteroids or protoplanets, and or they must have in their constituents a lot of complex organics. So it's quite likely that the early Earth was enriched by organics, but question is that where the these organics come from? Now, I mean, I talked about the organics in meteorites and comets, but we never really discussed any mechanism of making them, or we don't know how they were made. So there are a couple of possibilities. Now, these possibilities that I'm trying to promote is some of them could come from stars. Now, the evidence for that is the detection of stardust. Stardust meaning that a piece of mineral that carries the signature of an old star and not of the solar system. So there are a number of so-called p-solar grains. The first one detected was diamond, the most common is silicon carbide. It was discovered by two groups, one in Washington University in St. Louis, and another group by University of Chicago, and they all carry isotopic signatures which are not of the solar system. It's absolutely no doubt that we now can hold in our hands a piece of rock which came from old red giant star. So, if the stars can, as we have seen, the old stars are making a lot of minerals, they are being ejected, and they are spent all over the Milky Way galaxy, and at least some of them have been embedded in the early solar system, and they have fallen on Earth and allow us to pick them up and analyze them. So they have traveled a long way from the star to here. So what has happened in the last 20 years is that we are now aware that organics, or complex organics, is not the sole domain of the Earth, which we used to think to be the case. We know that they're everywhere in the solar system, they are in comets, they are in asteroids, they are in the planetary dust particles, they are in meteorites, they are in the surface of planetary satellites. And we also know now that old stars are quite capable, although we don't know how, making large quantities of complex organics over a very short period of time. The time scale we're able to put down is about several hundred years, because we're able to observe stars in different stages of evolution, separated by only a few hundred years. And they show changing signatures of complex organics. So we know that in a few hundred years they can form from one stage of complexity to the other. And this, we also know that this through the stellar wind process, they are being injected into the stellar medium, they are being set out at large quantities. These are not particular special type of stars. These are 95% of all stars that will evolve in our Milky Way. So every star, almost, in the Milky Way, we will go through this stage of making complex organics. Although the period that they make them are not very long, they are only talking about thousands of years. So, the organics and minerals that we see in the solar system in some way also have the counterparts in the environment of stars. So it is possible that these organics were deposited onto the surface of the Earth through the various process of external bombardment, and if they can survive and be preserved, then when the time is right for life to be created, then we have a pool of ingredients which are far richer than what, for example, we and Yuri were thinking about using the methane, whatever. So, in summary, we're saying that in the past 20-some years, we are able to learn that old stars are able to make complex organics as well as minerals. And they are being ejected into the solar system, into the Big Way galaxy through the process of stellar winds, and they therefore could likely be spread out all over the galaxy. And we now have direct evidence that we can hold in our hands of this stellar species, and although we don't have as good as evidence for the complex organics, but it is possible that complex organics were also deposited to Earth on a large scale in the early days of the Earth evolution. So whether they play any role to the origin of life, we don't know. But of course, but anyway, we are now scientists are looking at completely different set of pathways of creating life. Because in the past, we had to rely on very simple things, then now we have a much larger pool of materials to play with. Now, I'm trying to present to you in a very simplistic way, but if any of you are scientifically inclined, then you can look at some of these scientific articles which were published on the subject. Now, I'm passing around a copy of the book, and I don't know where it is now, and you can see that the book covers a lot more topics than I'm able to present in this hour. Some of them are, I think, quite interesting. For example, we're talking about diamonds in space, or celestial origin of more oil, or bacteria in space. But these are some of the things that we are all beginning to think about. I mean, obviously, we are still a long way from trying to understand the origin of life, but there is a great deal of excitement in the community, because we are now entering a domain where astronomers are talking to planetary scientists, talking to geologists, and talking to chemists and biologists, and trying to figure out whether there is any part of the process we are missing. So that's all I want to say. I'm happy to take any questions.
First of all, thank you for the interesting talk. But I want to ask, presumably most of the information you're getting is from within the Milky Way.
Yes.
Is there any evidence from other...
I didn't have time, but I forgot to mention this. Okay, now after ISO, there was another satellite, which is called SPISA, which is even more sensitive than ISO. Now, it is some unfortunate situation. The spectral resolution is not as good as ISO, so we don't get as much detailed information, but it can look a lot further.
Yeah.
Now, we have these kind of signatures all the way to redshift of 2, that means 10 billion years ago. Uh-huh. There are galaxies at the almost at the beginning that show signatures. Now, you can say, well, maybe they only just started to make carbon, right? Because it takes some several cycles of stellar evolution to make the element carbon. But what we are seeing is that as soon as there is carbon, there is organics. Not only there is organics, there are complex organics.
So it's very, very fast.
Yes.
Thank you.
Would you get into a situation of parallel evolutions this way? Say viruses or bacteria or bacteria and other streams of bacteria causing parallel evolutions?
Well, I mean, all we're seeing on Earth is one particular branch of biology, right? Due to circumstances or whatever, we develop into one branch of biology. But what we are saying is that we have a lot more ingredients to have multiple branches of biology. So, I mean, on Earth, we happen to have taken a certain path, but if that had happened in another planet, it could have taken a totally different path. The ingredients may be the same, okay? But it's the circumstances make them turn a different way along the path. Yeah, we just happen to use only 20 amino acids, whereas we have in our hands over 100 naturally made amino acids. Yes?
In some way, I see this, the prevalence of the organic molecules of all forms out there not associated with life.
Yes.
So doesn't that very much point that life is not directly related and associated with organic molecules?
That could be it, but where did life come from here? The hypothesis in the past 50 years have been they come from super molecules. Right? I mean, we're still going on that, except
that's one assumption.
Yeah. So maybe there's a totally different way. Maybe all these molecules lead to nowhere. I think that's what you're saying, right? Yeah, I mean, they could have lead to nowhere. Or if you're optimistic, you say there are thousands or millions of other planets which have benefited equally as a Earth from these bombardments, and they all independently evolve different kinds of life. Okay, that's optimistic way of looking. Yes.
If there were much more complex organic conglomerations in space in the interstellar medium, would we even be able to detect them for what they are? See that there were viruses and bacteria.
Oh, yes,
how
of course,
would we
of course.
Even detect those?
Oh, yeah, yeah, very good point. Now, I want to answer in two ways.
Okay.
Now, first is from gas phase molecules. Now, gas phase molecules are small. Okay, they are only 100 atoms or whatever. And so their chemical structures are well known. So they can be detected for sure. Okay, so the only question is sensitivity. Not only sensitivity. Actually, when a molecule gets to a certain complexity, say even a simple amino acid like glycine, okay, they have so many lines that they fill up the spectrum. And what we are facing here is more than sensitivity limit, because we have something called methanol, for example. We have millions of lines, and they are very common. They overwhelm every part of the signal that a telescope can detect. So when we go to the observations there, we have to first clean out all the methanols and see what is left over. And also, when you have a complex molecule, they are no longer symmetric. When they are not symmetric, their lines are much more complex and much weaker. So we are facing all kinds of problems. So I'm thinking there is a limit on how far we can go to directly detect gas phase molecules through the traditional method of millimeter wave rotational spectroscopy. Now, that's why we are excited about infrared spectroscopy. Infrared spectroscopy, we are talking about not trying to detect a single molecule. We are trying to detect a whole family of behavior. So, and that can be also compared to the laboratory. Now, of course, now what do I need? I would like a space telescope which has very high spectral resolution. Okay. We a number of us put a proposal to NASA about 10 years ago called Astrobiological Explorer, but it didn't make it. It wasn't selected, primarily because a lot of the astronomical community, they were more interested in sensitivity. They want to see things which are more distant. They don't want to see more details. Okay? But to answer your question, if I want to see, say, an organic complex compound, I want to compare with the laboratory, I need the spectral resolution. And I don't see that happening in the foreseeable future. But it can be done. Do I answer your question?
Partly, but yeah. I was extrapolating even farther than if you have light in space, we would not be able to detect it.
No, not in a remote sense. Okay, we would go to an asteroid, we can go to Mars, we can pick up something, that's the way you can detect life. But if you put a human beings, it would be very difficult. I mean, even bacteria. A bacteria is just some membranes, and you know, I mean, and they have infrared signatures. We do know what the bacteria look like in the infrared. But they are so similar to so many other things, it would be hard for us. Now we say this is a certain kind of bacteria. But it can be done.
I don't remember hearing about lunar soil findings that corroborate these.
No, nothing on wood. So far. That we know of.
No, why is that? Why did you see that lunar soil?
I don't know. I don't know whether we haven't collected extensive enough. I mean, they're only several regions. I mean, in the past, they are mostly interested, mostly geologists, they're only interested in minerals, you know. I mean, who knows? I've been looked hard enough in the right places. I don't know. I want to go back to the moon. I mean, the moon is easy, right? You go around and you send a rover. You pick up things and you bring them back. You know, and that's how you learn. I mean, like we send things to comets and to asteroids. And we receive all kinds of organics from O7. Yeah.
Listed in one of your first slides, but then you said nothing more about
it. Well, we, of course, like I was saying, I mean, we are not at a point of directly detecting lipid. We are talking about the chemical phases that could lead to lipids. I mean, we still have some distance.
So far, no.
Right, yeah. We are, for example, we want to detect the basis of the nuclear axis, and yet not yet successful. I mean, for the same reason, for the kind of reasons I'm giving you. Yeah.
Last century, Fred Hoyle proposed that whooping cough would break out when the Earth went through a comet's tail. And then chapter 17 of your book, you talk about bacteria in space.
Now, first of all, I say I don't know quite well. I have a huge amount of respect for Hoyle. The problem was that he lived too early. I am now still quoting Hoyle. I mean, the things that we are seeing today, Hoyle was saying 50 years ago. Of course, at that time, he had no evidence. That's the problem. You know, I last saw him in Savalania. In Spain, we had a conference of different spectroscopy. At that time, these things were just beginning. I assure you, have you had these kind of things, you'll be in good shape. But he's just too early, he's just born too early. He was a pioneer. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's extremely unfair to me even get the Nobel Prize because of people, his reputation was hurt by all these things. But that's sociology. I mean, from his work on nuclear synthesis, he definitely should get a Nobel Prize. But he was hurt by the other things that he was doing. Yes?
What do you think you will be talking about in 20 years?
One thing I've learned is that we can't predict anything. Almost none of these things I talk about were predicted. Okay. existence of stellar minerals, the existence of even gas-based molecules, and not let alone organics. None of them were predicted. I mean, they were found, and then we tried to explain that the conflict. Even that is not easy, you know. I mean, how? I mean, astronomy is still an exploratory science. We are still exploring, and thank goodness that we now can go above the Earth level stream. We have all kind of sophisticated detectors and can do all kinds of, you know. So I don't want to.
Yes. How's the James Webb going to help you?
Oh, wow. Should I say yes? I'm not keen about the James Webb.
So it's not going to help it.
Well, it costs a lot of money, first of all, right? You know, what's the latest thing? As far as he's raising the same question, he's going to have huge improvement in sensitivity, but he has done nothing for spectroscopy.
Okay.
Which is why I'm interested.
Thank you.
I brought a few copies of the book, so in case any one of you are interested in purchasing a copy, you can do so.
Any other questions? We will say thank you once again very much. Our September meeting will adjourn now. Don't forget, you all want to come up to the astronomy lab for a copy of cookies afterwards. Let us know.
Yeah, that's the